Good morning, my dear FB watchers. And it's really heartening to, we keep this time aside and there is so much of a thrill and excitement and preparedness that happens at office, you know, for this FB live. Topics are prepared in advance. And Sunita, I'll just ask her to tell her a hi to you. She's the one, you know, who really does a lot of things. To put this StreamYard in place and then to have, you know, these things in place. All these things Sunita does, our team sits down, thinks of the different topics which was happening earlier, which is happening now. So all these things happen at our academy. We also sit down and we actually mull over the topics which happened earlier, which happened now. And again, for the benefit of all those who may or may be a little in doubt about what Banjara is all about, I would like to tell you that we are a counseling house. I like to call it a house. It's like how, like a big family, right? Where people are all together, one helps the other, how it used to happen much earlier in joint families. So on those lines, so we are a counseling house and a training center. So counseling at the academy is totally free. Counseling relating to any kind of relationships issues. It could be with your boss, with your spouse, with your child, with your, you know, brother, with your colleague, with your neighbor, with your own self. You know, sometimes there could be introspection issues with your own self, identity issues with your own self. Whatever be it, counseling at the academy is free. And what is counseling all about? If you look at it, it's all about relationships, right? So I thought I'll take this opportunity to just share a few instances which could have possibly happened, you know, in your day-to-day lives, and a couple of them possibly happened in our day-to-day lives here. So maybe the first one would be that, you know, let's assume that you are going by auto and you don't have change. You give the auto guy 500 rupees. He says, hey, what is this, man? You don't have change. You say, no, I don't have change. You should keep change. What is this, madam? You people know you're educated, but you don't understand. Oh, you dare not call me all these things. I don't understand. Then what, madam? How will I have 500 rupee change? I'm just one poor auto guy. You say, what poor auto guy? You're getting it? How this banter keeps going back and forth, back and forth. So that is one situation. The second one is that let's assume that you are working in a good MNC or, you know, a very big organization. And in the pandemic, you have got pay loss. Kam ho gaya, bank account going little down because of your pay loss. That is the other one. The third situation which I would like to tell is that anyone in your family, you all feel that the boss is giving so many, you know, praises, applauds, and then says, oh, you are doing a fantastic job and I really see you going up. And this is how things are going to be taking shape for you. I'm really so happy to have you in my team. I'm proud of the different, you know, suggestions that you have given us. And comes March, comes April, May, June, no promotion you get. They say, no, I think we'll just consider that next time. And maybe I think, can we just discuss it later? And you are crestfallen, right? You're crestfallen. Now you're like, oh my God, he told me all these things. Now what happened? And then comes this thing. No, I've heard a lot of mothers. And just let me know your opinion on this, okay? I'll look out for some of your comments on the chat box. Let's assume your only child, maybe your daughter, maybe your son, comes and tells you, Amma, you know what? You just put me off in the boarding school, okay? They all say it's going to be nice over there. I'll have so much of freedom over there. You are so nagging. You keep scolding me. And you feel, oh my God, this only son of mine whom I have reared with so much of love and care and attention does not want me. Now what happens? Please write your comments. I'll be waiting for the, you know, whatever that you think of. And then comes another situation that your recently married daughter. You know, you ask her, hey, why don't you come down, Putta? We all want to see you. No, ma, I've got a lot of things to do at home. I can't come now. Maybe next week, maybe next week, maybe next week. And then she comes on a good festival day. And on that festival day, she says, you know what, ma, so much of kir 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 used to do. But my mother-in-law and my in-laws are so supportive. They are so modern. You never allowed me to wear any trouser or something. But all these people know, they're saying you should wear trouser, you should dress up modern. I'm really liking it. Now, I want you to just understand that there are different situations given. This auto guy, even if he tells you, you are educated, you don't have change for 500, you come home, you say, hey, what does he think? Yeah, get lost. You come back. And if you don't get your increment, you come home, you know, you crib with your own family members, you tell them, oh my God, see, we all have to adjust with this little money. We may not have so many luxuries as we did before. And then if you don't get your promotion, you know, your loved ones will tell you, yeah, I know, don't worry, look out for another job or wait for one more year. Can we all sit down and see where you went wrong, where you can improve yourself? Now, what is all this about? Your only son, if he tells you, Ma, I don't want to be with you, it hurts you. You cringe. And then, you know, you're brooding over it. Then you make extra biryani, extra good things for him. The difference being that if the auto guy tells you something, you don't care about it. If somebody jumps a queue in a metro and says, no, I was here, I was there, you don't much worry about it. Because they don't really, really bother you in your normal day-to-day life. So what is the botheration in other cases? They are your significant people in your life, in your family, and in your very, very close circles. And as we always say, no, hey, don't worry, I know him very well, he'll do it. I know very well, yeah, she will come. We sometimes take them for granted. And even when plants, no, we'll put a little water every day, right? Some haircut after 3 days, we'll get it done. Or, you know, if you have to buy some clothes, within a year, we'll go and do it. Today, we are going to be talking of nurturing these important relationships, of strengthening these close relationships. What is the impact? How can we do it? And what are the skills that are needed for us? So this will be brought to you all from Banjara Facebook Live just in a few seconds, maybe. Most welcome to the talk.
Extremely sorry for the delay. Relationships, close relationships, they affect us much more than any other single aspect in life. I may have financial problems, I may have health problems, I may have any other issues and problems. It doesn't affect me as much as if I have relationship problems. And relationships with whom? With our closest, most important, near and dear, etc. If I have good relationships with my nearest and closest people, I can handle anything. It is said that home or family is defined as the place where you go out and do whatever you want. And when you come back and knock on the door, they have to open the door and let you in. That is the beauty of close relationships, family, whatever you want to call it. Where and how does this start? Somebody very cutely said, when a small child, a baby, starts growing up, he or she goes through three stages. The first one is, hold me tight. When mummy lets go of the baby starts bawling. The moment mummy lifts her up and holds him tight, he's very happy. So the first phase is hold me tight. The second phase is put me down. Now I want to go and explore the world. So you put me down, I'll start crawling, I'll start walking, I'll go, whatever has to be done, I will do. The third stage is leave me alone. I've had enough of you guys. Okay, thank you very much. Keep cooking and feeding me. Give me my pocket money, but otherwise, please leave me alone. That's in a lighter vein, of course. But it, why I brought this up is that relationships start at a very early age. Relationships start at a very early age. And the way the relationships are on, light on. Light on. Thank you. Relationships start at a very early age. Everything depends on relationships. A child who does not get proper relationships, does not get, you know, love and care and cuddling and talking, may have everything else, physical security, economic security, you know, all these things, but still a child does not grow up with the same type of, the holistic development that the child needs. And then we enter into the adult world. What happens here? Ask yourself this, that everything revolves around your close relationship. In fact, when people ask me the concept of, let's say, mental health, today we are talking so much about well-being, mental health, and all these things, particularly after that very tragic suicide that took place in the Bollywood. When people ask me, you know, what, how do you define good mental health? I always tell them in very simple Rancho terms, peace within yourself and harmony with your significant people around you. Peace within yourself is entirely your call. You have to maintain certain skills, you have to develop certain, you know, self-awareness, management of your emotion, setting your motivation, all these things lead to peace within yourself. That's in your control. But the more tricky part of the thing is the harmony with others. And when I say others, I am talking about your significant others. You can have very good relationship in your entire locality, in your office, in your club, and wherever, and of course on social media. But how is your relationship with your nearest and dearest? That is what determines how happy, how fulfilled, how contented you are. That is what determines what sort of steps you will take, what sort of actions you will take, how you will, you know, feel motivated, how you will balance your life, how you will, you know, face challenges and all these type of things. So let's start with some very quick and basic things about relationship. Then we'll move on. As I said, we'll have a lot of questions and doubts and comments and all that. Let's make it interactive in the second half particularly. So let me start off with first thing telling you that, you know, all relationships are dynamic. They keep changing. So this thing of, you know, A and B married and lived happily ever after, I think is a big misnomer, which is causing a lot of misconceptions and making people feel very contented with themselves, because you think that once you've found the ideal relationship, then everything goes fine. No. Relationships are all dynamic. Relationships keep changing from time to time. I remember this wonderful old lady who was maybe at that time around 85 or so, and she had her husband more or less of the same age. And, you know, she used to very happily tell her husband that, you know, I love you today. Tomorrow, I don't know. Next month, I don't know. Next year, I don't know. But I want to express to you that I love you today. It was such a beautiful thought by a person who had been married for 60 years to the same man and who had continued living with him for 60 years and loving him. But she was realistic enough to say that I love you today. How many of us have got that ability to say it? And how many of us on the receiving end will be happy to get, you know, a truthful message like that? But that is a fact. So be prepared that all relationships are changing. They are dynamic, they are not static. The second thing equally important is that relationships need to be nurtured. The closer the relationship, the greater the nurturing has to take place. You cannot take relationships for granted. most of the close relationships that have deteriorated or even have fizzled off completely, my experience has been that it is did not happen overnight. People think that way. Oh, we were having such a good relationship, we were such good friends, or between husband and wife, we were so happy, or my relationship with my child was fantastic. Then one fine day, something happened, and they say everything has gone for a toss. It doesn't happen that way. It is like a big tree which has come up, and you look at that huge tree and you say, great, fantastic. See how strong it is. Nobody, nothing can shake this tree. But somewhere if you look deep down into the roots, you will realize that the roots are not getting the type of nutrition. And therefore the tree is becoming weaker. Or you may have white ants, you know, deep inside the tree trunk, which are eating up the trunk and making it hollow, and you won't even realize till one fine day the whole thing just topples over. So the same way, relationships have to be nurtured at all times. Please never ever take any relationship for granted, however close it is. Sorry to say something very controversial, which many of you may not like and may even get angry with me for saying it. There is no such thing as unconditional love. If that was the case, then you know nobody would put any conditions on their love. So once a man and woman say that you know we live happily ever after, they would say, go enjoy yourself, as many boyfriends and girlfriends, spend off all your money, do whatever you want, and I'll give you unconditional love. Let's be pragmatic, no? It doesn't happen that way. And why it doesn't happen that way is the third aspect of relationships I wanted to tell you, that all relationships are built on expectations. If you have outside your house on your way to work, maybe a beggar, a person who is physically challenged, who cannot earn for himself. So he is there, poor man, and he is asking for charity. And you give it to him. You give him money or you give him food or whatever it is. You know, you take care of a lot of his needs every now and then. And you even say hi to him and he pays his respects to you, whatever happens. But would you say you have a relationship with him? Would you like to invite him to your house on your birthday and say, come and join us for our birthday party? No. At the most, you will make some goodies and sweets and tell somebody, go and give it to that poor beggar who's sitting outside on the road. So the point is that we do not have a relationship. And therefore, there are no expectations. But if you have, let's say, a neighbor to whom you have been doing some good deeds, you've been helping her out, you've been sharing food whenever, you know, there is a need there or something. If you really want that to evolve into a friendship, you start having expectations. One fine day you get up and say, every time I'm doing so much for her and she's not doing anything for me, I think I'd like to cool off. That is only a relationship like a neighbor or a friend or whatever it is. Now, I am talking about very close relationships, your own family people, maybe your parents, siblings, spouse, child, anybody who you consider your best friend and that sort of thing. It does not exist without expectations. The only issue is, are the expectations reasonable according to the other person? If they are not, if the other person feels tense, constrained, pulled, if the other person feels that no, this expectation from the other person is too much for me, I can't come up to that expectations, that is when the relationship starts deteriorating. That brings me to another very important issue. When I mention close relationships, they should not be too close. Anyway, this corona has taught us that, you know, you maintain social distancing from each other. I am also talking about emotional distancing every now and then. Do you cling on to each other? Do you want everything to be done together? Do you want to be physically together 24/7? Do you want all activities to be done only together? Take an example. Suppose your friend comes and says, oh, we've been locked up for so many days. Now, when once everything is through, we have decided that we'll go and have a nice vacation and we will unwind and we will have the joys of being away from home and all those type of things. We'll do that and we'll come back. Both my husband and wife have decided that. So you ask, where are you going? And she says, my husband loves beaches, so he's going to Goa. I love the hills, so I am going to Ooty. How does it sound? The other person who's listening will probably say that at the end of the marriage, if they can't even take a vacation together, how long is this marriage going to last out? I'll tell you how long. It will last out much longer and in a much better quality of relationship than most of the people who force each other and go for vacations together or something of that sort. Yes, Shika, thanks that you agree that there's no unconditional love. Please think over, those of you who disagree with me, do give it a thought. So I come back to the point that you need to give space to each other. You need to understand each other's needs and say that, okay. And we need to give the other person what the other person wants, not thrust something down their throat. Just to give a simple example, in this last 2-3 months, I have had so many people who have decided to lock up their parents. The government locked them up, fine. The government has unlocked them, but the children don't want to unlock them. They don't want them to step out of the house. They don't want them to meet anybody. They don't want them to do anything just because they are senior citizens. Now, if you allow me to be a little impertinent, I think all the people who are ruling our country are senior citizens. I think we should first lock them up, isn't it? No, we can't do that. Yes, you have to take precautions, but you can't label them. The same thing is happening with children. You can't permanently lock up people. So you have to give space. You have to understand what their needs are. That's how you need to move on. Now, if you are under pressure, if you have a close relationship and that person is becoming a little, what do you say, dominating, and the person is not allowing you to do what you want, how do you deal with it? Dealing with it, you need to learn a very basic human skill. It's not very difficult, but it takes a lot of practice to actually master it after you understood the nuances. That is a skill called assertiveness. Can you be assertive with the other person? Most of the time, we are either dominating or we are submissive. Alice has said just now very nicely that I find a middle way, negotiate with close relationships. Yes, how do you negotiate this? You have to be assertive. You don't argue, you don't fight, and you don't give in. There's a middle path, which is always available to you. So when you look at this middle path and how to go about the thing, let me first show you what is not assertiveness, and then we'll see what is assertiveness. So here is a parent and child who are having differences on certain things. When they are not assertive, just see how they deal with it.
Meera, what is this? Your room is again so messy. You're so shabby. Why don't you clean your room?
So what? It's my room. I do whatever I want.
I mean, you're always like that. I told you every time and you don't listen to me. Everybody says this about you.
Let them say. I don't.
You have to clean this. I don't know how you do that.
I like living like this. Please don't interfere.
I don't know what I can do with this girl.
This is what happens. This is what happens. The mother has become helpless, saying, I don't know what to do with this girl. But if the same mother was assertive instead of starting off shouting at her daughter, how would she deal with it?
Hey, Meera, I know you've been busy with your exams and you've not found the time to clean your room. But you know what? I'd like you to clean your room.
Whatever, I don't feel like.
You know what, Meera? Your grandmom's coming this Sunday and she'd feel very welcomed, right, if you clean your room and keep it ready.
Okay, whatever.
Yeah, so you know what you do? By Saturday, you clean the room. And if you think you need any help, let me know. But let me know a little bit in advance so that I can just wrap up other things and come and help you out. All right?
Okay, will you help me?
I'll do that. Let me know.
Bye. Okay, but just this one time. Okay?
Sure, love.
Okay.
Nice. Good.
Now, don't expect miracles. Don't expect that you are assertive and suddenly your rebellious teenager becomes very, very obedient and very, very loving. It doesn't happen. But nothing happens overnight. You have to work towards it. This was just a quick demo to help you to understand that you have to make that beginning. You have to start moving in that particular direction. As long as you are doing that, it takes time, it takes effort. There will be ups and downs, but eventually you will succeed. This applies for any type of thing. For example, let's say in any close relationship, inevitably, you can't always be nice to the person. You can't always be smiling and say, okay, do what you want and I'm happy whichever way and things like that. No, it doesn't work that way. There are times when you have to discipline somebody. There are times when you have to criticize somebody. There are times when you have to stop somebody from, and I'm not even talking about parenting and children. It could be, as I mentioned, it could be your elder parent, you know, who is saying something which you don't like and you want to bring about a change. It could be just about anybody as long as it's a close relationship. So what do? We tend to criticize the person. We tend to put the person down by saying, you are good for nothing, you are doing this wrong, you are doing that, all those type of things, isn't it? And this continuously has a sort of negative effect. We don't even realize how much the relationship is getting damaged, how much strain is building up between the two people. Just because we are part of family or we are closely connected or something of that sort, it just goes on like that. But we have to take care. I'm not saying you should stop criticizing people. You should if it's a person close to you and if you feel that constructive criticism and suggestions will help. It will bring about the change. So you have to criticize. But don't do it in a way that it makes matters worse. Instead of motivating the person to change, it actually makes the person adamant. That's what happens sometimes. How? Let us see.
Still not ready, Sunita.
Are just give me a few minutes here.
Are you going? You're getting late. Everybody's waiting for you. You're always getting us late.
I'm not always late.
Last time also we missed the movie because of you. This is not done at all. I don't like this about you at all.
If the movie is so important, not you guys carry on. I'll get an auto or something.
Done. Go.
See what happened? It started with good intention, but it has ended up in a very, very wrong note. Now, can the same person say, I want to be critical, I want to help her to change her habit, but I'll do it in a more constructive or a more positive manner. How?
Sunita, ready?
Yeah, just 2 minutes. Why don't you guys carry on in an auto, yeah?
Hey, no, you'll all get messed up in an auto. And you know what, you wanted to go together, right? So, let's do that. And moreover, look, you're looking so pretty, you're looking so good, and we decided to go together. It's always fun to have you around. No, we have to go together, right? But you know what? You have to be a little more punctual, so take care of the time the next time.
Yeah, I know. Next time I'll ensure that, all right? So this time, just give me 2 minutes.
1 minute?
Okay, right, I'm ready.
Right, that's it.
You may be thinking, does it work? You may immediately be thinking of somebody in your family or somebody close to you and say, hey, I've tried all these things, yeah, it doesn't work. You know why? Because you tried it once, twice, got frustrated, criticized the person even more. See, I was so nice to you, I allowed you this and I did that and still nothing happened. Now, habits take a long time to build. We have to work on that. Let me wind up the first part, half of this session, by giving you just a few very important and very quick tips. Then we will have an open house. Please feel free to start typing in your doubts, questions and comments and things like that. But before that, as I told you, one is that society and families and all that are moving more and more into what we are defining, what we are referring to as undefined relationships. Earlier, we were bound to our own family, our joint family, our extended family, our community members and all that. Now that is no longer true, right? So every time that you are building a relationship with new people, please be aware that it's very easy to have a quick thing, good initial, opinions or people just being, putting on a good impression and the thing starting off well. But many a time it does not last. So I have a request to you. If you feel the need to build up more and more relationships, friends and this and that, please first work on your existing relationships. If there is something wrong and if you are criticizing all the time and saying these relationships are not working out well, that's why I'm trying out new ones, it doesn't help. Lot of people make that mistake. It doesn't work that way. Please keep working on your close relationship. How much do you express your love and affection? I always bring this up in a lighter way. That, in English, it's such a common thing to tell somebody, I love you. But ask yourself, are you equally comfortable saying just the simple message of I love you in your mother tongue? People falter. People don't know what to say. And when I ask them, when did you last say this to somebody with whom you have a long-term close relationship? Many people have not done it. If you're doing it, I'm extremely happy. Some people even go to the extent of saying, my wife knows that I love her. Why do I have to keep repeating all the time? Doesn't it sound silly? No, it doesn't sound silly. It's very reinforcing. It strengthens the relationship. Just to get to know verbally. And back it up with non-verbal things. At least with your near and dear, I'm sure that nobody will mind if you don't maintain social distancing. Touch, for example, plays such an important role in life. And now that you are abstaining from touch from others because of this lockdown and restrictions and all that, at least with your immediate near ones, use as much touch as possible. It really reinforces the relationship, and it really makes the thing go into a very, very positive demeanor. The last point. Never be an emotional beggar. Do not beg for love. You don't get it. I come back to the example that I gave you about the roadside beggar to whom you give food. You don't build a relationship with him. You don't invite him home. You don't make him part of your celebrations or anything of that sort. So the same thing happens with somebody who is an emotional beggar. If I go on begging, whoever it may be, my parent, my sibling, my spouse, my child, whoever it is, if I keep begging for, love, I only get charity. I don't get a chance to convert that love into a two-way relationship, which is what our intention should be. So please keep working on that. Just a few very important and simple points. I'd like Purnima to just give you a quick update on what we do in terms of building stronger relationships and things of that sort. And then let's have an open house.
That was a wonderful video about strengthening close relationships. And Dr. Ali is here with us. Before he joins you, I just wanted to inform you about the courses that we are currently having. International Certificate in Life Skills, that is a course which is just started and still open for registrations. World Health Organization has come up with 10 life skills which are really very essential for everyone to practice in their lives, so that they can have a fulfilling and satisfying and successful life. So this is what we have also taken up and impart online course on all these life skills. Plus there are 6 to 7 other important skills which Dr. Ali has identified, which would make sense to learn during these latest times, like something like technology, how we are getting addicted to that, skills regarding diversity of people. There are so many different people all around who are coming into our lives, and how do we interact with them. So there is a lot of wonderful concepts and skills which we are talking about in this course, and it's totally online. So those who would like to register, you feel free to get in touch with us at at the numbers which we have mentioned right here. And then of course our very own flagship course, Diploma in Counseling Skills. It's starting in June, but then early bird offers are up now. So please do get in touch with us and we can discuss in detail if you're interested in counseling other people, as well as it's more of a self-awareness and introspective practical course wherein you learn how to interact with people, you learn how to understand human beings' behavior, emotions and all that. So even if it is for your own self, it would be something which will be of great help. And so without further ado, or without much ado, let me put on Dr. Ali. Yes, there is. There you
go. Yes, I'm back. I'm also looking at the chat box to see, after so much of my speaking, whether anything came to your mind where you would like to make some comments. As I always say, agreement, disagreements, everything is welcome. So while I keep looking at that chat box, let me end up with whatever I had told you so far in just one simple message. Invest in people. Please invest in people. You invest for your future in land, buildings, gold, shares, mutual funds, all these fixed deposits and all that. One of the most important things and the best thing that you can do in life is to invest in people. Okay. Surekha says the boy is suddenly choosing to distance himself in a long distance relationship. The girl is terribly disturbed as all efforts are frustrated. What should she do? See, if I were to be talking to this girl, I would first help her to understand what she needs. I just mentioned a little while back, if you remember, while winding up the first half, saying that do not be an emotional beggar. If he is choosing to distance himself and he does not give you logical answer, or there is no issue to be resolved, but he just wants to drift away or something, I would help this girl to build up her self-esteem, to be more comfortable with herself, and then reach out to either this boy or anybody else. So the issue, if I were to be interacting with this girl, is to help her with herself rather than with her relationship with this boy. That will resolve itself, or it may break, or anything may happen. As I mentioned earlier also, relationships are always dynamic. You don't know who will come in your life and you don't know who will walk out of your life, but life should continue regardless. Yes, Niti, I agree that when you beg for love, you only get charity, nothing more than that. And nobody wants to live on charity, isn't it? Jayashree rightly says, love is something from within. It cannot be forced or commanded. Yes, love is a pure emotion which comes, goes like any other emotion. You feel angry, you feel jealous, you feel excited, you feel thrilled, you feel the same way you feel love also. But it's a beautiful emotion. It really enriches you. The more love you sort of, build up in yourself, the more you learn how to give love, the better is your qualities life. Yes, Nageshree, mother's love towards her children is not unconditional. There is no such thing as unconditional love when we are talking about loving relationships. Please remember that. You can have unconditional love towards God or towards your guru or towards somebody like that, towards a celebrity whom you really admire and things of that sort. But that is not converting into a loving relationship. Today we are talking about strengthening relationships, isn't it? Vinita says, sometimes, as you said, yes, we keep nurturing our relationship, but still it gets very difficult in few relationships to understand. And then just to avoid some conflict or confrontation, we stay quiet, which I feel is not right, but we still do it. That's where I come back, even, to the question that Surekha raised about this girl whose boyfriend is, distancing himself. Why do we feel that just to avoid conflict or confrontation? If I am a peace-loving person, if I know that I am not creating confrontation and things of that sort, but as long as I am doing it in the proper manner, I will have success, I will not have success. In fact, that's what Satyavati just now said, invest in people is a very nice concept. But at times, it always is disappointing. Haven't you invested in some shares and it disappointed you? Haven't you invested in property and it has disappointed you? Haven't you invested in a fixed deposit in a bank and the bank closed down? That does not mean that the concept of investment is bad. It only means your choice was bad. Right, Farida? Investing in people and stock market is the same, but with a slight difference. People are comparatively more predictable than the stock market. Stock market, only very great experts can find out where the stock market will go up or down, and even there they make mistakes. But let me tell you that if you become a good observer of human beings, if you have your self-esteem in the right place, as I was telling you, if you are not an emotional beggar and you analyze people and then decide whom to invest and how much to invest, you can do it. Yes, even then I agree with Farida that there are times when there will be suddenly a crash or something of that sort. It doesn't matter. Overall, you will be able to maintain healthy relationship. Okay. Anuradha says the parent is being taken for granted and feel that they are controlled. How does the parent draw a line yet be there? Now, of course, it depends entirely on the age of the child. If it's a small child who's under your control and this and that, the situation is different. If we are talking about a grown-up child, and as a parent, I am feeling that my child who is grown up now is trying to control me and things of that sort, please go back to reading Khalil Gibran, who said, your children do not belong to you. They are through you, but they are not of you. And if nothing else, learn from birds, learn from the eagle who kicks out her eaglets from a nest which is 1,000 feet high up on a cliff, taking that chance that this child, when I push her out, will learn to spread her wings and soar and will not crash to the ground. Similar attitude we should have as parents. I have done due diligence. I have, you know, taken care, and we have moved on. Sunita's question is, who should be lived and how much? I presume it is who should be loved and how much. Yes, agreed, Sunita. From time to time, even let me tell you that also. You need not have an absolute thing that, you know, I have to always, keep loving the same person to the same extent and things of that sort. I remind you again of that old cartoon of Beetle Bailey, the army fellow. The general and his wife, who must have been married for maybe 40, 50 years, they are lying down side by side in the bed and they are both reading a book. The wife sees something and gets a doubt and turns to her husband and says, do you still love me? The husband, you know, looks over his reading glasses at his wife and says, you mean I have a choice? Think over it, okay? Karima says, how to handle expectations in close relationship? They are poles apart. Yes. There are people who have unreasonable expectations. There are people who put people down. At breakfast time, I just watched a few minutes of that very touching Bollywood movie called Secret Superstar. That little girl who's aspiring to become a singer, and the way her father behaves, not only with her, but with his wife, the way he keeps, you know, crashing at her self-esteem, physically, mentally. There are so many people around us who do that. But somewhere we have to, as they also did, you know, break that cord and say enough is enough and I'm going to move on with life. And for that, you need to have your self-esteem and your confidence levels intact. Farida says, in early years of marriage, people indulge in investing in people, especially women. I think this hurried investment brings up disappointment. Not necessarily, Farida. What I'm saying is, yes, you start a beautiful relationship immediately after marriage, but you have to adapt it from time to time. There's nothing wrong in giving all your love and affection to start off with the relationship, any relationship, not just marriage. And once you realize that this is not going okay, we should take those in. That is where we fail. We go on thinking that the more I keep loving him, the more I keep adapting myself, the more I keep adjusting, someday he will wake up and he will be nice to me. That does not happen. In fact, the person starts presuming that because even when I am bad to you and you still listen to me, that means probably what I am doing is right. So you are giving me the license to go ahead and do what I want. This is something which I keep telling a lot of people who are in what we call, you know, this abusive relationship or one-sided relationship, a person who's very dominant, egoistic or something of that sort. So when you are in a relationship like that, I tell them that please, even though I sound very cruel to you, do not negate the fact that you have contributed to making a monster out of that person by being adjusting, by being docile, by forgiving all the time. You have actually encouraged the person. If you had nipped it in the bud right in the beginning, the moment you said, yes, since you mentioned marriage, I'm only taking that as an example. Yes, I married you with all love and affection. I wanted to give the best of myself and I wanted to ensure that this relationship is very happy. But I find that you're not reciprocating and the relationship has to be two-way. Or as one of you suggested, you have too many unrealistic expectations that all the time I should be behind you and I should be doing whatever you want. I cannot do that. I'm also a human being with my own needs and also wants. Don't forget the second part of it. It's not just my needs, it is my wants also which are important.
Ali, yes, that reminds me a thing which my friend just told me. Apparently her husband bought a 4,000 rupees handbag for his friend's wife as a gift. And for her, with the same breath, he buys a 600 rupees handbag, you know, and then he comes and gives it to her. So she's like, why would you do that? You know, for somebody else's wife, you bought that. But he's like, no, you are the kind who uses this kind of handbag, right? She doesn't use, you know, she doesn't accept anything less than 4,000 rupees one. So she's like, no, I have only taught him to buy me, you know, cotton dresses and ordinary handbags. You know, I have trained my husband to buy me lesser money stuff, you know, something like that.
Wonderful example, Sunita. We see this sort of thing day in and day out. People who say, I don't want to impose on my husband. I don't want to make unnecessary demands. I will adjust with small things. I don't want to, even if I get this craving that I should have a good fancy handbag, at least one of them, I say, no, no, no. Why spend 4,000 rupees on a handbag? A 600 rupee handbag serves the purpose equally. So what am I doing? I'm constantly, you know, conveying this message to my husband. I'm not justifying the husband's actions, not at all. But I'm just saying that please be aware that you are contributing towards this. Now, if you contribute like this and you find that the husband buys a 4,000 rupee handbag for his friend's wife, saying that she is very particular, she will not use a handbag unless it is branded and the branded bags cost nothing less than 4,000 rupees. So that's why I had to buy that for her. So what you have done is, if you are upset at this point, you have first created a monster and now you are becoming, you know, upset about it. Anyway, doesn't matter. Let's take this scenario itself. Now you are upset. Instead of fighting with the person, instead of creating unpleasantness, instead of questioning and pointing fingers and this and that, use it now as a lesson, okay? Tell the husband, thank you very much. You bought this bag for me. It's very practical. It is very useful. I will go ahead with it. Stop. Let it go. Let the incident go past. That's what I always say. Never deal with difficult situations when you are tense, when there's a stress, when there's conflict between people. When you are in a far better mood, when there is no conflict happening and nothing of that sort, that is the time you bring up the thing and say, you know, all my life, I have tried to live a life of minimalism and frugal living, and I've never aspired for things which are better. Today, when we are in a better financial position, and today as I grow a little older and I, you know, also have certain dreams and aspirations, I was thinking that I should also go in for some good things. So it could be a dress, it could be a bag, it could be an ornament, it could be just about anything. This is something that I am aspiring for. I'm not saying that you should buy it for me immediately, but would you please keep it in mind next time when you have some money, next time when you're in the mood to give a gift or something. I think I would like to have a branded shoe or a branded bag or whatever it is. Or I particularly admire that particular type of thing, product, you know, which is a little expensive. But somehow I have this desire that one day I should own that. Let's see as and when it happens, keep it in mind. See, this is how you sow the seed in the other person's mind. And all relationships, I repeat what I told you in the beginning, that they need to be nurtured like a tree. Meeta says, Ali, I feel understanding relationship is like an ocean. We have to just keep investing, nurturing, and learning. At the same time, let me tell you one thing also. Yes, you take a boat and get into the ocean. Are you worried that there is a storm 1,000 miles away? No, no. What are you concerned about? You are concerned about your boat, the vicinity, the surrounding, the weather, the waves, or whatever is happening around you. The ocean may be 5,000 miles long, but your concern is probably in the next 5 miles where I have my destination or I have to move. How is it? So create your own little world. Create your own little emotion. Start with the small things. We call this, you know, the inner circle and the next circle and the outer circle. There's a ripple effect which goes out. Start with creating your little world, your little ocean. There again, in some places it will not happen, some places it will happen. What does a good seafarer do? He is going westward. His destination is on the west. But there's this huge storm on the west and he knows his boat is going to capsize if he tries to go. He changes direction. He realizes that if he moves towards southwest, he can brave the winds and whatever it is. He's going a little away from his goal. It doesn't matter. He can always turn back and come. So in many of these relationships which you need to strengthen, there are storms. Brave the storms. Ride the storms. And I have seen life is very long. You don't know. You cannot predict how things will be 1 month, 1 year, 10 years, 20 years down the line. But keep working towards strengthening these relationships. What is the next question or comment? As I wait, Lata says, such a pleasure listening to you again. Thanks a lot, Lata. Good to connect back also with you. Whenever I connect with our old friends, old students, I really feel nice. Because one thing that I have seen is that, you know, this is exactly what I talk about, you know, relationships. We need not be in touch. We need not be living in the same city. We need not be having common interests or something. But, you know, if you leave a mark on each other's mind and you say, hey, this person is a good guy. This is a person whom I can trust. This is a person whom I can emote or connect with. It's such a nice, warm feeling. I have friends like you who I may not have spoken to you in the last 1 year or 10 years, but I still feel connected. And that connectedness, you know, is something like what I was telling you, an investment. Supposing you put in some post office savings bank account for 7 years. You put it in that fixed deposit. The rules say for 7 years, you cannot withdraw money from there. Doesn't matter. You still have that feeling of warmth that so much of my investment is there in the safe hands of the government of India. And eventually it will come to me. And it will come to me with interest, with profits. So I will be able to avail of it. Just that thought gives you so much of positivity and a feeling that, yes, today if I am having a bad financial crisis, I can still overcome that. Raji says sometimes maintaining relationships with emotionally sensitive people are exhausting. What do I do? See, running fast for 10 miles is exhausting for me. But I can perhaps run 2 miles without getting too exhausted. So what do? I run 2 miles, take rest, or I don't stop, but I slow down and I just, you know, casually walk there. Maybe I take a glass of water or some fresh thing, which, drink or something of that sort. Once I do that, I am again re-energized. So the same way as you, when you're exhausted physically, you need that either the gap or the rest or the little bit of, energizer or something. The same thing applies to the mind. So when you find that you are getting exhausted, slow down, take a break, re-energize yourself mentally and continue. That person is important to you. Sureka says, how do twins who are always bickering coexist with each other? It doesn't matter whether they are twins or siblings or best friends. As I was mentioning a little while back, we are moving more and more into undefined relationships, right? So we have to be aware that any relationship today has this question mark. I have a twin, I have a sibling, I have a cousin, I have a best friend. The important thing to understand is, how important is that person to me? Do I value this person? Do I value this relationship? If so, I will make efforts in all these little directions or steps, as I've told you, and it continues. There are so many things, even every now and then, I keep finding some new ways of looking at things. Last Thursday, I had the classroom session, and nowadays, people have become so webinar friendly that nobody even wants to go and sit in a hall and enjoy a cup of tea and sit with people and have a nice fresh thing. That's another way where we are losing out on relationships. Let me tell you that very few people came. It doesn't matter. To me, numbers are not important at all. But I had this session on when love is not reciprocated. This is an area of immense interest to me, because day in and day out, I keep coming across people who feel miserable because they love, but they do not get back love. And these are the type of issues which I keep working on constantly. I keep learning from people whom I interact with. I learn from the experiences of others who have gone through good and bad times. And I may not have gone through the same thing, but having such people sharing with me, interacting with me itself gives me a lot of insights. Parveen says, how to explain to a person with bipolar illness that mutual expectation is okay and not one side? It is very, very challenging to live with a person with bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, bipolar. These are very, very challenging, relationships. I would like to discuss personally with you on these things, depending on what the situation is, what's your relationship with the person. Please feel free to write to us constantly. We've been giving our website or my email ID and all that. If you want to write confidentially about something which is very personal, you can write even to my personal ID, which is alikhwaja50@gmail.com. alikhwaja50@gmail.com. Something which may be a little confidential or something deep or something, you can write to me. I make it a point to reply all the emails, but I am slow and I'm not very tech savvy, so don't expect a response immediately, but you will get a response. That much I can assure you. And that is one way of maintaining relationship. I make a simple thing. I mean, I'm not trying to show off or something. I'm just sharing with you a simple formula that I use is that I will never neglect a person. I will, unless it's a forward or some such ridiculous thing or mass mail or something, then of course I don't neglect. But if this is happening, I do make sure that I do not delete a mail unless and until I reply. I take my time, I think over, I draft out a proper reply, thought over, and then only that's how it continues. Thanks for telling us about your child. That's what I said. Depending on what the child is doing, she's 20 years old, and today, what is the situation? What have been your experiences so far? If you can discuss all that, then I'll take you forward. Farida says, being completely dependent on either emotionally or financially forces people to pretend they are in love. They also believe it themselves eventually. Yes, I know that's a topic by itself, but we have been discussing these sort of things from time to time. And there's a lot more, as you know, relationships, human lives, and life skills, and all these things are an endless thing. But one thing I can tell you is life can be very enjoyable if you take it up as a challenge, as something good. It's like the batsman who goes out to play, to bat on the crease. He takes it up as a challenge. He can be out for a zero also. He can hit a century. He doesn't know. But if he takes it up as a challenge, he thoroughly enjoys whatever batting he does. Life is also like that. Let us keep batting. Let us keep bowling. Let us keep fielding. Let us keep doing wicket keeping. But at all times, keeping up a positive mental attitude and taking others along with us, investing in people. Keep that mantra with you and keep practicing it from time to time. Have a wonderful weekend. See you again next Saturday. Bye-bye.